I was quite tired. I'd been out in nature all day, so I was like, you know, you get this lovely tiredness when you have been outdoors. But I was quite, you know, tired. Yeah. Anyways, so I hope someone got something out of that, though. But for today, anyways, and as I said before, if you have any questions, let me know.
Choose that again for some time, or maybe whatever, for not for
can you still choose more freely. But anyways, for the resting, I think I was about related to Ayurveda, and so it can be different things, you know, just to change scenery, or some people, you know, that are very active and very ambitious, they constantly, they burn themselves out, kind of split the energy, the fire energy, and because their problem is very much to balance rest and activity, that's usually their main problem. Some feel that, or think that, to rest you need to kind of lay down and do nothing, and they get like really, really, really restless when doing so. So that's not maybe the best way. Sometimes it could be absolutely the best way, but many times it's just to do something else, something that is different from what you were doing that is relaxing. If you, for example, is very also what parts of yourself you use, for example, if you're very intellectual, to find some resting for your mind, doing something physical or yeah, whatever it is that you need, that you feel gets a little bit unbalanced and or that needs some rest. I guess that is one of my main connections, and the whole balance thing, those I'm drawn to explore those in many, many ways. So I also maybe I should mention that briefly, since I now suddenly dip my toe in Ayurveda briefly, that for example those doshas, those are the general energies that we all have in various balance within ourselves. So the Prakriti, the one we are, basically, when we came here, we are all unique and individual. We have an individual balance of these that can get out of balance. And we are most healthy and feel the best if we get back to that basic balance, which then are different for each and every person. So it's not that you should have the same equal amount of those doshas like kapha, pitta and vata, but to find a way back to your natural balance where you are the healthiest, and that is not the same as someone else's balance. And so therefore the treatment for certain ailments will differ when it comes to Ayurveda. It won't be the exact same as it is more like in Western. If you come with a problem, you will meet it in a similar way for whomever the patient or the client is. So anyways, so for a kapha person, for example, they need to activate themselves. I have a lot of kapha physically, you know. They really need to, also when it comes to food, not eating those foods that are more sedating or dulling, because you get even more slower, like, and so that would be more balancing and resting for a kapha to actually activate and stimulate both their minds and bodies, oftentimes, depending on where you can have one dosha being stronger in your body and one in your mind, for example. That's not so uncommon. But also, by the way, I should maybe, if you haven't heard very much about Ayurveda, maybe I should just say that kapha would be the water and earth element, and that is the qualities of those. I mean, the way they act, you can say, very much. Anyways, that is kapha, and pitta is mostly fiery and also a little bit water, and so they are a little bit, as fire and water, they are a little bit either or. artist maybe sometimes, and then and also very ambitious and intelligent and everything. And every one of those doshas do have their benefits. So for example, kapha is the healthiest one. They almost never get sick, and they're very, very stable. When they change something, they stay. They are not easily swayed in either direction. They follow their own self. And also they are not easily fooled, in the sense that they really don't buy into things too easily. They need to, if they get it, then they need to kind of okay, I won't go into that, but they are like more grounded and will maybe not even be interested in all those higher realms if they're very, very kapha and have not much of the other doshas within them. They will be more interested in the like more obvious things, and not even, it's not so much that they question things, but they just don't believe things that are far out there that they can't really like prove. Or it's not that they really need, that is more the people that want to prove things, but that are kind of obvious to them. That's in that realm they live in. The kapha more like in this physical, obvious, stable world, let's say. Yeah, they are very grounded, solid personalities as well, and trustworthy and everything. But anyways, when it comes to pittas, then they can't like find a middle way. Like when it comes to resting, then that should be a topic here, and I should try to focus on the tool. For them, it's more, they can't like be somewhat active, you know, and then somewhat, I mean, find a, let's say, a balance over a day maybe, so that it would be awesome and probably suggested to have some relaxed time within a day or so. But you know, most kavas, most they are all in. So when they do something, you can't like stop that, but you can find a way to maybe when you have like exhausted yourself in a way, then to give yourself some relaxed time, even maybe more so than you want to, or to shift into getting all into something different to give yourself that relaxation. And when it comes to vata, then, which, oh yeah, so it would be the, and vata is the air and space dosha, and I have mostly of kapha and vata, at least some say so. There are those who say that I have a lot of pitta, but I think if you test those things online, the thing it will show is probably what you are, how the balance is now, and that may be quite different from your prakriti, your natural state. So I probably have been quite high on pitta many times, although that may not be my natural, or maybe it would, because I've always sedated myself with the food and stuff, so I'm not sure if the kapha is more of a vata disturbance. Oh no, I'm going too far in that. But the vata, then, they are kind of the opposite of kapha in a way. They are not grounded. All addictions are vata, for example. That's like this more nervous, erratic, and also those who are more drawn to and interested in spiritual things and pick up things more easily, like in a intuitive and psychic sense. And so, and what else? Anyways, for vata, it's very important to eat regularly, sleep regularly, and that's like the most difficult thing for vata, because you're just enthusiastic very much in like every direction. And you know, talking like me is very much vata, not keeping that. Some people that make videos, I'm quite impressed. impressed by those who keep to a topic and like say exactly what they want to say in quite a calm manner sometimes even. And then they say just what is needed and then nothing more, and you kind of get it. Very nice. But then again, if you're Vata, that's wouldn't be the case. So I have a lot of that, obviously, because if I just had a kapha, I would just be so freaking slow and yeah. And I wouldn't talk a lot. Kaphas don't, Vata personalities, the mouth goes very quickly and much. Yeah. So, and the mind as well. But the Pitta ones are the more intellectual and ambitious and focused persons. So, for Vata, nature and groundedness being work with earth, element of earth, but also two Vata personalities, since the nervous system is so activated all the time, and also actually at night time with dreams, maybe the communication there, but you really, really need to sleep more. A kapha person that are so grounded and so relaxed in themselves, they can't hardly become shaken. They are so cool, you know. They really don't need a lot of sleep. They can feel as balanced even if they get like a few hours of sleep every night. But a Vata would need at least maybe 10 hours to be really truly balanced, while a Pitta is somewhere there in between. And when it comes to food, also just you can check all this up, so I wouldn't go too far into those differences, but it really has some importance when it comes to how to find a way to relax. And Vata could more easily just lay down and fall asleep, or just take a shower and relax and so on. While since they are affected so easily by small triggers in that sense, they also easily get very. I mean, you don't need too strong measures to calm the Vata, because they are so receptive and sensitive, as well as to in the other direction of them. But yeah, when it comes to food, also for a kapha, there are also certain tastes and so on that would matter. But just briefly, since water and earth is cold, they also would need warmth. But also like veggies, and this springtime, as it is here in Sweden anyways, is kapha time. So to cleanse and to eat more veggies and those kinds of things. This is like a slow time when you can do that without putting so much strain on the body, because the body is very strong. The kapha is so solid and strong, you know. So you can also add exercise more without getting injured and so on this time. And also between 6 and 10 in the morning, or 6 and 10. Is kapha time during the day. But anyways, okay, drifting. But so those kinds of foods and beans, the drier foods, because it's water, then you easily contain more water when you're kapha and so on. So like vegetarian food sometimes may be better, and not too much fat and so on, obviously. And yeah, but and that would also give your body a rest. As for example, a Vata would be really stressed out from those kinds of things, too much cleansing or too much light food or dry food, because Vata really needs the heaviness, much water, while Kapha need very little water actually. And a Vata would need to drink quite a lot, because they are very dry in the skin and all kinds of things. And they need also warm food, but more heavy and more like Kichari, if you know that kind of yogic like soup things, but when things are mixed together and not too fragmented on the plate and so. And also natural sources than the worst kinds of. But anyways, and for the pita, then they are, as I said, this fire is hot. Yeah, and also sometimes that they have charisma. It really shines in their eyes, so they are kind of hot that way too. But they and can become more easily angry and so on. Just don't also, we don't allow ourselves, we obviously. obviously, oftentimes at least, we know, at least we can try various things, and if we don't know how to rest, we can try various things that others find restful then, and see if it works, and eventually probably we'll find a way to relax ourselves. And also the priorities get in the right order. There is so much that happened, and also the immune system gets strengthened, everything good happens. And also, I love this practice in yoga when you breathe in and out, and you always breathe in and out. But you know, there is a practice when you stop, when you breathe out, and wait until the body breathes in. You don't force yourself to wait, you just don't by automatically, you don't automatically just breathe in and out in a certain rhythm, but you allow yourself to let the breath slow down and deepen in a natural way, but you still wait, you don't rush it. So that's, at least for me, that's such a calming practice, to allow the body to decide when to breathe in again, and just like wait for that, and breathe out, and then wait, however long it will wait, and I breathe in, and yeah, and that is something that can be taken into the rest of life, and to like allow resting time, because yeah, that is so much more healthy. And it's not always like restful to be lazy or postpone things, or that's like stressful, you know. So, and as I said, what's resting for one person may be really stressful for someone else. Yeah. But I think that's a good tool and very needed. Whatever you want to do, really, we need that balance to kind of defragment ourselves, maybe also as a talking about soul retrieval and all that. And yeah, by the way, about maybe I should go into the things that I do sometimes, like really talking about. I say that many times, but then I get drifting into something else. But I mean, those various things, there are many things that I do, but that I don't do all the time, let's say. The mediumship, and so that side is always there, and many, I mean, there are always people who need it, and also I pick up naturally or spontaneously things all the time, so that kind of goes on. But when it comes to past lives, for example, no, I don't do them online. I've even been hesitating just to have these brief things out, where some years ago I had some little journey of sorts in Swedish in that direction and so on. But since I have had quite a huge psychosis when I was younger and so on, and I know how sensitive one can be, even that I've hesitated to do. But then again, I feel it's everything is out there anyway, so. But personally, I wouldn't do that. I mean, I could journey for someone if I would pick up something spontaneously. I would probably, if someone wanted to hear it, tell it. But and I could go into that for someone else. But then again, I think it's more. It means more to you if you yourself have experienced it, or seen it and been there. It's also with the, I mean, you can experience it in so many ways. The communication I also talked about in my, a little bit, my previous video, is very much visual to me. It's clairvoyant, but to many, it can come in many ways that are as valid. It's nothing wrong with them. It's just that usually we believe what we see, it's true. If we see it, so it will for a person to experience it themselves, whether they would journey to meet their totem spirit guide or, yeah, so, or past lives, it will reflect the now also, so, yeah, whatever the situation is now, that can be of help as a key to, like, unlock and see things as in the now, but I would like to be with that person, and even then, I don't take on that, like, if someone would come and ask me for it, I wouldn't just do that. I would probably, I usually don't go into specific. I mean, there have been people that wanted to try these kinds of things, and I've let them do that because they find it interesting or fun or whatnot, but usually I'm guided by what the spirits show that would be beneficial for that person. So I wouldn't just do all kinds of things just for the fun of it. So, yeah. And also, I would want to sit by that person. I mean, it's something to listen to it online, and that can even be maybe more relaxing to some people. But since I know how strong things can be, I would love to sit there and both. It's easier to guide someone when you see how they breathe and their eye movements, and you can like follow the process. You can even journey meanwhile, but usually I don't. I just guide them. And so I wouldn't want to. I would feel irresponsible even letting some content out when it comes to those kinds of things. I feel a little bit. I've hesitated, as I said, for many years to even do that, even briefly, because I feel that's a little bit often irresponsible. I'm trying to find how to discern that for myself, so that I can feel comfortable with what I do, and you know, responsible. So no, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't guide someone online, and I wouldn't journey. I guess no, I wouldn't, unless spirit would let me know that then. And preferably if I was with them face to face, like in the same room. But I'm not saying it's wrong, and I think, for example, Lunar Wisdom do that with cards. Sugar channel out, and but there are many other things that I do that are in the same way. They are like, if you could call them like tools or methods, at least, you know. But I would want to be guided by spirit to use them. Yeah, I mean, I want, yeah. So then I feel I trust that is good, best for the person. Then, but it happens though if someone asks me for one of those specific things that I do, that I would do it anyway. Even Ayurveda, I wouldn't I would share, but I wouldn't like jump onto someone and suggest that, even if I wouldn't be guided to it, because I think they wouldn't take it in. It wouldn't be especially, or maybe it wouldn't even fit them, that way of viewing things, or I don't know. But I can, for example, you know, everything is interconnected and everything relates. So for you, maybe, I don't know, maybe you have previously lived a similar life as Jack, or maybe even if that would be in this lifetime. So that doesn't have to be like in previous life, but oftentimes certain themes that we work with in this life come up again. So, and also, as I mentioned before, I mean, I've met other psychics that have said, like, you were a native chief in a different life, and that was then, when I was quite young, when someone said that, I was really skeptical. I said, okay, what was my name then? You know, I was really, like, questioning things. I don't think I got a name, but I was like, oh, yes, that's typical. Outside of Stockholm somewhere, they had these, you know, many, I don't know what it's called now, but they have these little tables with various New Age huge things, like a huge place with lots of various things, you know. And you could kind of go into someone there who would, you know, tell you things like past life, I don't know. And I really doubted that, but then again, I don't know that. I've seen several of my own previous lives, so I mean I've seen them myself. So maybe that was right, I don't know. But also another one who told me that I was dying, starving as a small boy, I think, in Africa and so on. I don't know, still I have not seen that myself or so I don't know. I died very young then, and that was kind of related to my eating disorder, I guess then, but it felt like a to me then, because I'm very skeptical and question everything, I thought, oh, that is like, what a cop out to say that. Like, that would be an easy way to, but that could be true. I've just not seen it myself, so it makes much stronger impact if I see things myself. But anyways, we often go through themes, several lives, until we have learned it. In not the same exact thing, but similarly, we learn something though, for each life. I would assume and hope. And so there may be connections there, and even if it wouldn't be our specific life, or if it's just, let's say, imagination or whatever, it still would reflect something. So, since that seemed to be a theme for you, maybe it also can be connected to writing or music, artistic things. And also, it can be this shadow aspect, you know. If you still have that within you, for example, to write, then maybe that need to come out, and maybe someone then write online or troll people online or whatever, just because they haven't seen that, they don't understand how to channel that, which they are, and the way they need to express it really to benefit themselves and others. So, I mean, and that I don't mean in psychic sense at all. I just think that things that seem important in the here and now also reflect back, as well as the previous things reflect now. That was nice. I've talked for long now again. I try to make shorter videos, it doesn't work well. But you know, but what I can say though, I mean, you didn't ask for an actual reading, but I asked for the shaman, maybe you have that part in you. Because shamans are like wounded healers, and I can see that you have that aside from the whole card there and so, but just. As I said, the best way to do something like that is to be with someone that can guide you. If you trust this person, if you really feel either that you trust yourself so much so you can relax in the hands of being with someone else guiding you, or that you, I don't know, it's just a different process to be with someone, but it shouldn't be someone you really, really doubt or you think that. Yeah, you know, you feel really not safe with, that would be not so helpful, I guess. But to me, since I always question others, and myself, I guess, also, but I guess I wouldn't benefit as much being with someone to journey through some tapes or CDs or whatever. I mean, I really don't want to be influenced too much by others, so I would always change it, even those, until I really learned. If I, for example, Brian Lewis, I trust him very much, so I wouldn't hesitate to go into his meditations or whatever. But otherwise, I have that thing, and always did, also with the witchy or those kinds of things. I do something else. I don't follow. less as a protective measure, so I would even stray more so from the guidance if I was sitting by someone, because I wouldn't trust where they would go with it, I guess. So to me, it's really more relaxing and helpful to do it actually by myself. If it was not someone I totally could relax with, then, and that could happen, but so far I haven't done that. Yeah, I guess I should not go into all the other things, but maybe briefly then, you know, muscle testing, that's the way you're feeling it through your body. You can just do that without like doing other psychic, but oftentimes I've realized that oftentimes if I do something like that, although it may be as valid and good and so, the difference between using a method just like that, although it still is messages from spirit, I think, to us in a good way, it won't take into account whether we are open to those messages, so it would just be like futile. It wouldn't help much. People would just dismiss it and don't, and wouldn't like, I mean, yeah, it wouldn't help. And sometimes that can really help if I see that if someone would if I see, I mean, if the spirits let me know that particular using that method would be helpful for the person, then I can see also the results that they really do take it in. But sometimes you also don't know, maybe later on they would or whatever. That's good probably for them in some way, even though I can't see it always. But so what else? Yeah, the massages and everything that includes Ayurveda, as well as the chakra flow and yeah, those kinds of things, with the orange chakras and cleansing and so on. But there are also different variations of healing methods that may, I mean, they may affect someone more, I mean, what they are receptive to. It may vary what way you do that, or if you would use like drumming or certain things. I thought about that, having that sometime in the background a little bit. Drumming though, I would love that myself. But in these videos, but you know, it varies so much. But let's see now, what else do I really do then? Yeah, all kinds of journeying, of course, and also so that others could journey themselves, which would have probably a stronger effect oftentimes in their minds. But then again, the healing process of journey for someone would be as efficient whether they are aware of what happens or not. But yeah, all those kinds of divinations, as I mentioned also, and various ways you can do that. And of course, if you don't, we call them witchcraft or magic, various ways you can do that for yourself or others. But that influences whether a person is aware of that or not, but I wouldn't do that unless someone asked me specifically for that. And yeah, in the same manner, I wouldn't I wouldn't for sure do that just because someone asked. I would want to be guided myself to do that as well. Oh, well, what else then? Munaki, those practices though, I would always do if someone asked me. I don't know why I have those various, I just feel that for example, Munaki, that is like loving energy. That is that way to work with shamanism, that is, I think you should have respect for all the methods they also use, soul retrieval and so on, but it's still, I can't see that ever can be a harmful practice, or even that it could be indifferent, that it wouldn't have any effect. It would. So I guess that I would do. Even at a distance, you obviously can work with that, but journeys themselves, when you journey, you like ask permission at that time to dive deeper or go into certain thing, and you know that's all, not always that they would let you do that, even for yourself, and even more so maybe if you journey for someone else. Probably, but sometimes it can really help, and also help to